Okay, so this is the explanation forum for this Heston baler. Let me turn my lights on here. Now, I try to do the best job that I can do as far as explaining what I'm doing while I am doing it. The reason I'm doing it, the problems that I'm trying to cure by doing this particular upgrade, function, or job. And yet there are still people out there that just cannot listen and comprehend what I've said. So, here it goes. All right, so, first thing, I put plastic in the floor of the pre-charge chamber. As a matter of fact, I put plastic from the very front of the stuffer area where the packer forks go, or the packer area, and then to the trip plate area, and then I extended it on through the pre-charge chamber. There are three functions in the first 6 feet of this baler that needed to be addressed. They are commonly known problems throughout Heston baler owners everywhere. In damp hay, these balers were not designed to bale damp hay. They were designed really primarily for a straw crop. So, when you get into a damper crop area like mulch hay or even a silage situation, which these things can bale silage hay, that steel becomes sticky. You know, it's like if you take wet grass, if you take dry grass and run it across a piece of shiny steel, it just slides right along. But if you add that third element of water, that dampness, it'll actually roll and rope on the steel. You can just, and it'll roll right in your hands. So how do you alleviate that problem? You put plastic in there, poly. You poly line it. As a matter of fact, every baler manufacturer, with the exception of Krohn does not have a poly liner in it, but Heston does. I know they do. New Holland has for years. They don't last very long, but they are in there. But the Hestons of old and the New Hollands of old and all the other baler companies of old were steel, and that was it. So steel wears pretty rapidly when it's subjected to that kind of harsh condition. So I put the plastic in, and it did exactly what I wanted it to do. So it allowed that damper material to slide right up to the top of the precharge chamber easily. Not difficult, but easily. Now, it did not create a problem, per se, at all. It didn't create any problem at all. It was a solution. There is an existing problem with this particular baler that I didn't know about, and probably 90% of Heston owners, the 4900, 48, 49, 4910 baler owners, don't know that their baler is doing this. And that is that the holdback fingers on the precharge chamber, the precharge chamber, are not long enough. They could be 2 inches longer. I may even modify these a little bit more, but I didn't really, I haven't touched the fingers at all. But, okay, so what has happened is they're not quite long enough, and you've got this huge bale chamber, which is 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and a half inches wide at the top. And I'm going to demonstrate what this is. If you notice here at the bottom, about 8 inches there. But when you get up at the top here, it increases in size at the top. So you've got this small amount of hay that's coming through there at a high velocity, and it's going right up to the top. But if it's light, really light hay, and it's not enough to trip that pan, it will actually go over top of the 4.5-inch fingers that are in there. So my idea, whether it is a good idea or not, I don't know yet, because I haven't ran it in the field. I haven't had the opportunity, and that was to put these little baffles in here. It was not to make the hay not slide up the top. It was to actually force the hay inward towards the holdback fingers. This will not restrict anything in here. It won't. It's going to force it into the fingers in the top, actually creating a more packed slice of hay or a flake of hay in there, so that it is a more compressed slice of hay that will be held easily by the hold back fingers. So that's why I put them in there. Now, is it going to work? I have no clue. I'm hoping that it does. Did I waste my time if it doesn't work? No. I just learned that that wasn't the solution to my problem. The next solution to the problem, or the next idea that I have for a solution to this problem, will be to cut those out of there. And I've thought about this extensively over the last couple of days after I built this, is actually cut those things out of there and go get some half inch thick cold rolled steel or hot rolled steel, which is pretty soft, not cold, hot rolled steel, pretty soft, mild metal, and make ramps that are at the very top, skeleton ramps, instead of those hard pan, you know, flat surface friction building pieces of metal. Just enough to press it into the hold back fingers, just enough to hold it, put it into the hold back fingers on the back of the baler. That should be just enough to hold 90% of that hay in place back there. Not a lot, 90% of it, that's fine. If I can close that gap up so that there's that much of a gap in there between the hold back fingers, which are going to move out of the way 4 more inches, and then these are just skeletons, so they're just going to kind of stay there, and the hay will go around it. It doesn't really pack super tight at the bottom or at the top. It's rather loose at the top because of the expansion. So that was the one fix, the one major fix that I think I've got the problem solved. The other is that trip pan with the little stones and stuff in there. Someone told me to seal it up with silicone. Silicone will be like a glue. That's not going to work. The whole idea is to keep the dirt and dust and shit to fall out the bottom so that it doesn't build in there. And that, what you need, and I thought that I had explained it in the video, was that I moved this stopper here. So what this stopper does is it allows the floor pan to lift up higher, and any of the stones that are in there can fall through, the little stones, they can fall through. And then when you build pressure and trip this thing, it will just smash down on there. These forks actually hit that pan, and so if there's anything, dirt or something jamming in there, it'll break it. It'll just break it off. So that problem is, I'd say, pretty well solved. I put the new hoses in there. They're set up so that they don't break. They've got springs on them. I'm not having any problems as of yet. I will be keeping my eyes on those on the crankshaft there, on the packer forks, where the grease, there's plenty of grease going through there. I don't know why anybody would think that there wouldn't be. Grease is grease, and as long as it's going through it, it's going through it, it's good. So hopefully that problem is alleviated. I don't know. It just kind of is disheartening that people cannot understand what I'm saying. I always thought I was pretty clear. I've always felt that I was pretty clear. But whatever. People are people, and they're going to do what they're going to do. I'm going to put this thing in the field as soon as I get sunshine, and we're going to bail with it. We're just going to bail with it, and if it doesn't work, then I cut it out, and I waste, you know, a couple hours of time cutting that out of there and welding something else in. I'll be okay with welding something else in. So, and the other thing that those little ramps do is when the stuffer goes all the way to the top, it leaves about 6 or 8 inches of 6 or 8 inches of hay at the top when it cuts it off, and that will fall all the way to the bottom, which is denser than the new hay going in, and it could potentially cause problems. So what happens is it actually falls down onto those ramps, and then so it's already there, and that ends up at the top of the bale instead of at the bottom of the bale, or wherever the hell it ends up or falls out as dust, because it does beat it up pretty hard. But anyways, as far as this baler is concerned, it is what it is. And I know I had somebody ask me, well, you're putting all this time and work into it and effort, why are you going to sell it? Well, I don't need three balers. Yes, three balers. I have a project that I will be doing next June, and I'll let you guys in on that little secret when I have my contract signed and I know everything that I will be doing. But there's going to be 6 weeks in June, or 4 weeks in June and 2 weeks in July, that I will be doing a job baling for a company, and they need my balers. This baler, even though it will bale really well in straw, it's not going to do what I want it to do while I'm there. So this baler is going to go out the door. I'm getting a brand new chrome baler. No, I haven't started pricing them yet. I just want to have all my ducks in a row before I go to Messex and tell them that, I ate a hot dog and I shouldn't have. Before I go to Messex and tell them, hey, I need a brand new 1290 HDP high speed, I want to be sure that I'm going to have this particular job and what it entails and how many people I'm going to be employing to do this job. So, but that's something to look forward to. I've already got a buyer for the baler. He seems to be pretty happy about what I'm doing to it, and he's excited to own it when I'm done. And, if he doesn't like the baffles that I put in, if it doesn't apply to him, then he can take them out. I don't care. Just as long as it works for me. Or maybe that'll work so good that he'll be putting them in his baler. So, but anyways, that's just, it's just bullshit. You know, dealing with people online can be exhausting. I mean, when you do what I do on the farm here, whether I'm baling, mowing, raking, stacking, retrieving, fixing. I mean, I show a lot of repair videos, and I get comments of people that say, oh, God, I'll never buy a John Deere because you're always fixing them. My neighbor up the road runs new internationals, international harvester, Case CNH, Magnums, and he fixes them too. He fixes them too. They all have their faults and they have their problems, and they're just, they just don't put it online that they're doing these repairs. It's kind of silly that people would say, oh, well, them John Deere's are junk because you're always fixing them. If you don't use them, you don't have to fix them. You know, that's just a cold hard fact. If you run internationals or CNH or New Case New Holland or Case IH tractors or equipment, and you're using them on a regular basis, guess what, pal? You're gonna be fixing them too. Oop, somebody sent me a thing. Wow. Yeah. Yep. And that's kind of cool. But anyway, so just sit back and enjoy the show. I mean, if this fails, I'll show it. I mean, you know me better than that. If you're new to the channel, you'll know that I show my failures as well as my successes. And this, I think, is going to be a success. In the end, it'll be a success. And to be honest with you, when I bought the baler, there were just a few very minor things that needed to be done to it to get it into the field. I just wanted to go over it thoroughly so that it was perfect going into the field. And yes, it worked wonderfully. I have no problems with it. It worked great. I mean, we've already baled over 500 bales with it in the 6 days of work that we've had. The first couple of days were short days, and when we got into real hay, he was baling over 100 bales a day with it, which is great, without any problems other than the rocks in the door. And what happened with the thin plastic wasn't that it tore up or anything. I had two layers of plastic, and what was happening is they were doing this at the top. And when you're in a really dirty, dusty environment, they started doing this and then swelling up because they filled with dirt. There was actually 3 inches of dirt in the bottom of that thing in some spots. When Cody pulled it out, he dumped it out on the ground. There was a pile 8 inches tall and, a nice big 4 foot wide, 8 inches tall pile. So yeah, that had to be replaced. I put, obviously, the half-inch board in, like you saw earlier, and I siliconed it so I don't have that problem again. But anyways, that's enough of me complaining about complainers or people that don't know how to understand what I'm doing. And if you're a critic, cool. I like criticism. I really do. Constructive criticism. There's a difference between constructive criticism and blatant, disrespectful criticism. I don't mind being criticized if you have something to bring to the table. If you have nothing to offer, nothing to bring to the table, go home, stay home, stop watching my channel. If you want to see a farm that does perfect stuff all day long, every day, they're out there. You can do searches. I know lots of farming channels that never show 1/100th of what I do. And that's okay. That's their choice. And I appreciate those guys as well. So have a nice one. Thanks for watching. You can comment, rate, and subscribe if you want to. Nobody's holding a gun to your head. I'm going to shut the lights off here because I got other things to do.